Hello, this is Dr. Oster. Welcome back to Oster Oncology. Today we are going to be focusing on prostate cancer. We're going to be looking at some anatomy, some physiology. We'll be discussing some testing. We'll discuss your Gleason scores and how that impacts treatment. We'll talk about side effects and risk factors as well. So let's get into this. Anatomy-wise, we're looking at the prostate. It finds itself located just below, just inferior to the bladder. So you see the kidneys up above, the bladder and the prostate is the green there. Now, the prostate receives from the testicles the semen that's produced there up through a tube called the vas deferens, you see labeled there as well. So when the sperm at the time of ejaculation rises up through the vas deferens and finds itself passing through the prostate has secretions that it contributes to the ejaculate as well. So it increases the volume. Actually, what the prostate contributes is about one third of the total volume of the ejaculate, but also it releases a very specific enzyme called the prostate specific antigen, which helps with the achieve the proper viscosity. So it actually liquefies the ejaculate a little bit so it gets the right viscosity. So to look at the PSA, which we will discuss a little bit further as well clinically, but if we look at it physiologically, if we zoom in on the prostate here, we see that the prostate is made up of glands. So you see that these glands are structured in a network of channels that are lined with very specific cells that produce the PSA. So if I magnify in on these glands, this glandular aspect, these glandular tubes and channels of the prostate, we see that they're made up of a single layer of cells. And on the inside, as I'm drawing here, which would be to the left, on the inside of the tube, if you see I've curved it a little bit there, to the left and to the right. To the right we have the tissue of the prostate, there's circulation and blood there, and then the internal gland, the channels of the gland would be to the left, and the blood would be to the right. So these cells will produce prostate-specific antigen, and the majority of it is produced and put into the inner channel of the glandular network. And so here I'm drawing some PSA for you here. And again, the majority is concentrated within the lumen or the inner tubing of the glands. So that's prostate-specific antigen. We also see that some of it is released outside of the glandular network into the tissue. And so we'll get back to that in a second. But if we look at some numbers here, I wanted to give you guys a reference range on what is normal PSA and what is abnormal PSA as well. So if we look at normal levels, this is pre-diagnostic levels. We actually want these levels lower if you've already been diagnosed and been treated for prostate cancer. But the normal range finds anything below 4.0. This is measured in nanograms per mil. So anything below 4.0 is a normal value. 4 to 10 is something that you would want to monitor and follow up on. It is high, so it is out of the normal range. It is not diagnostic on its own, though. We can't say that that's clearly prostate cancer. A measurement of PSA above 10, though, we do find that 50% of those cases will have a positive biopsy, will have a biopsy showing that there is prostate cancer. Anything above 20 increases the risk that we're actually dealing with a metastatic case, that we have disease that has escaped the prostate capsule. So if we zoom in on the PSA that's actually found in the tissue and in the blood, not necessarily in the lumen of the glandular network, this is what we're measuring in your blood, guys. So we're measuring PSA that's been released into the blood and is not being contributed to the ejaculate in the glandular tissue of the prostate. So there's two forms of PSA that are measured, and this is very important. There's free PSA, which is free floating, and then there is bound PSA. So the bound PSA is the PSA molecule is connected to a little carrier protein called alpha macroglobulin, and we find these two forms. Now, they are very helpful diagnostically in predicting what we're dealing with clinically when we do see an abnormal PSA elevation. And that is because in cancer, we do see an increased contribution or concentration of bound PSA compared to other cases. So when we're looking at, for instance, BPH, 25% is free, where in a cancer case, we typically see more bound PSA compared to free PSA. So the free PSA drops actually to about 10%. And we can do a quick calculation here from your blood tests, which is how PSA is tested. And you can see how much percentage-wise is your free PSA a percentage of your total PSA. And so again, when we're looking at BPH versus, which is benign prostatic hypertrophy, which is a benign enlargement inflammation of the prostate, compared to prostate cancer, this ratio, these percentages, if you're closer to 25% or if you are closer to 10%. Another measurement for PSA is your PSA velocity, and velocity is the speed at which we see a rise in your PSA numbers compared to prior testing that you've had. So over time, whatever we see in terms of the velocity is an indication, again, are we dealing with something that is benign or are we dealing with something that is malignant? PSA doubling time is another aspect, another way to measure this as well. How much time does it take for a prior level PSA measurement to actually double in size? And if that happens in less than 10 months, if a prior PSA level doubles in under 10 months, then it's a concern. And if you already have had a diagnosis and treatment, then it's a sign that we may be dealing with a recurrence. Another test that may be run by your oncologist is something called the 4K score. Now, the 4K score is a test that allows us to predict the chance that we're dealing with a Gleason score of 7. I'm going to talk to you about what a Gleason score is in a second. We'll unpack Gleason score. But you can run your 4K score as well. And this is done prior to a biopsy. It's a blood test as well. And it tests something called the human kallikrein 2 or HK2. And when we see that increase in measurement, then it gives us an indication that we may be dealing with a Gleason 7 or above compared to a Gleason 6, which makes a big difference in terms of your treatment and what will be recommended to you. So that can be done before a biopsy is run. Now, your Gleason score is the definitive test, though, from a biopsy. This is still definitive on making predictions on what treatment you need. So your Gleason score is not from a blood test. It's actually, you need tissue for this, so it does come from a biopsy from the prostate. And you'll see that there's Gleason scores of, generally we're dealing clinically with Gleason scores of 6, 7, or 8 to 10. And they are broken up this way because of prognostic differences as well as treatment differences. So your Gleason score is a measurement of something we call differentiation. And differentiation can sometimes be best described as tissue-specific appearance. So it's actually looking at the cells. It's a pathologist looking at the cells. We also call this morphology. What do the cells actually look like? And so when a cell, just to give you an idea of what differentiation means, if we're looking at a stem cell, so I'll draw a little red stem cell here. And stem cells can divide, and when they typically do, one of the offspring, the daughters, will be another stem cell. So you see I drew one stem cell dividing into another stem cell, but also in a particular tissue, it will divide and change into a cell that looks different because it starts to pick up the responsibility of a certain function depending on the tissue it finds itself in. So in this case, it turns into a prostate cell. So you see, I'll draw it. They are shaped differently, and it looks like a prostate cell. It has been differentiated to a specific appearance based on the tissue it finds itself a part of. And as that prostate cell divides over time, it maintains that appearance. Now, if we have a mutation, however, in a prostate cell and it becomes malignant, I'll try to draw it as sort of different shaped here. It's more of a cube. And as it divides again and again with that malfunction, as it passes it down the lineage of cells, you'll see that it starts to, I'll draw them as circles here, it starts to look different. And so on the left, we have a prostate cell that is a rectangle, and we call that well differentiated. It's been well differentiated to take a specific role, and it looks specific as well to the tissue it finds itself in. With poorly differentiated on the right, we find that we know that it's malignant. It's not maintaining its proper shape and appearance as a prostate cell should, and we know it's correlated with an increased aggression, proliferation, and risk of metastasis as well. So again, this is tissue-specific appearance. We can also call this the specialization of the cell towards its role in the prostate. So to the left again, looking above at the shape of the cells, we have highly specialized cells, which is healthy and good. Again, this is called well differentiated, and we have poorly differentiated on the right. So a Gleason score will increase the more poorly differentiated a cell appears. So a higher score with Gleason is worse than a lower score with Gleason. So a six, Gleason 6 is prognostically better than a Gleason 8, 9, or 10, for instance. Okay, so what is the significance to treatment here then? So when we look at these Gleason scores, and I'll put them in a bit of a chart here, a Gleason 6 versus a Gleason 7 versus a higher range of Gleason 8 to 10. And we know that treatment will be different for them because they have different prognostic risks associated with them becoming a malignant case. So a Gleason 6 is very slow growing, and it can often be just treated with active surveillance, whereas a Gleason 7, you're going to be offered either or surgery or radiation therapy. Radiation therapy can be external beam or high dose rate or low dose rate brachytherapy as well. Now, when we get into the higher Gleason scores of 8 to 10, we can also consider, you'll also be recommended surgery or radiation, but also endocrine therapy can be introduced. That can happen with Gleason 7 as well, actually. Or we can also be offered by your oncologist chemotherapy. The common chemotherapy that is used is called Taxotere or docetaxel. And it has shown in local prostate cancer, so this is not metastatic, it's a local case of a high Gleason score, that it seems to impact overall survival, progression-free survival, disease-free survival as well. So it's a question mark if that will be offered to you by your oncologist or not with a higher Gleason score. And that would be delivered after you've received either surgery or radiation. So that's the significance of Gleason, guys. Your Gleason score, it is quite prognostic, and therefore treatments will follow whatever that score is. Now, all of these treatments, everything's so tightly packed in the pelvis, guys. The anatomy, everything is so tightly packed. So whether it's surgery or radiation or the anti-testosterone endocrine therapy, we may be dealing with side effects. Erectile dysfunction is the common one. Urinary function and deficiencies is another one. And especially on the endocrine therapies, we may be dealing with hot flashes. So, I didn't even list here the side effects from Taxotere as well, which is low blood counts and such. So bringing in the integrative piece, which is what we do here at Oster Oncology for erectile dysfunction, arginine can be used. And then there's so many things that we can use to help with urinary function. And there's a lot of different options to take away those hot flashes from you too. So you don't have to struggle on your treatments, guys. It's one of the things that we really like to help our men through, whatever the treatment may be, radiation, recovering from radiation or surgery, or using the endocrine therapies, and certainly protecting you on the Taxotere. So I wanted to throw in a piece here on risk factors just to consider. These are risk factors that are associated with an increased incidence of prostate cancer and not necessarily progression of existing an existing diagnosis of prostate cancer. So some of the risk factors we know are dietary, what we do to ourselves, increased alcohol intake, animal fat, smoking is clearly associated with prostate cancer, pesticide use, that's agricultural, as also, golfing, a lot of golfers have an increased risk as well, decreased vegetable and cruciferous vegetables as well. Not enough vegetables intake, guys. And then there's a genetic component to this too. This is hereditary. About 10 to 15% of prostate cancer has a hereditary component, BRCA 1 and 2. And then there's a Lynch syndrome that can increase your risk as well if you are hereditary, if you've received this from your parents. And those are genes MSH2 and MLH1. It's not an exhausted list of the genetic factors, but those are the risk factors for you. So if we just end the video here with some anti-cancer natural options that have evidence behind them, guys. We need evidence to show activity against prostate cancer. This can be at the cellular level, but that's really not good enough. We want to see a lot of cellular data. Some xenograft or animal models are good as well, but certainly we'd love to see some clinical trials with patients showing biological activity against prostate cancer. And so the top four probably would be curcumin, EGCG is from green tea, it's a green tea extract, resveratrol, and ellagic acid is from pomegranate. It's an extract from pomegranate, which is very specific. Now there was a trial done called the POMI-T trial. It was with men that had Gleason 6 that were on active surveillance, and it assessed men on or off of this combination of natural compounds. And what they found was only in the treatment group, compared to the control that did not receive these natural compounds, only the group that received the natural compounds saw a decrease in their PSA velocity, a decrease in their PSA doubling time, and they did not have to enter into active treatment. So we see biological activity against prostate cancer. Now a question does arise, is it actually a benefit to prostate cancer patients? And you would ask, why wouldn't it be? Well, we do know that there's a class of drugs called 5-alpha reductase inhibitors. So you see that 5-alpha R drugs. And we know that from recent studies that men that are on Gleason 6 that are on 5-alpha reductase inhibitors, which are used for BPH, have been shown to decrease the identification of metastatic cases. So where a PSA would have skyrocketed, these 5-alpha reductase inhibitors actually inhibited that rise, delayed the diagnosis, delayed the treatment, and we saw an increased risk in metastatic cases, which is, of course, not the purpose of these drugs. But when we look at these natural compounds and we look at the wealth of preclinical studies, we see that all of the PSA-lowering activities are all associated with anti-cancer activities as well. So just for summary, guys, we see that the PSA is made within the glands. We can measure it different ways with velocity, free PSA percentage, and doubling time. We talked about the Gleason score and how it's a measurement of tissue-specific appearance or differentiation. We spoke of how the Gleason score can predict associated risk in your case, prognosis, and the appropriate treatments that are going to be recommended. Side effects, risk factors, and anti-cancer natural options. Integrative medicine is here for you guys. So in all of these ways, Oster Oncology can come alongside you to complement your conventional treatment. This is not a substitute. This is to help you tolerate. This is to help you prevent. This is to help you fight stronger and decrease your risk long term. So if you like this video, please feel free to repost it, share it, subscribe to our channel, visit us at www.osteroncology.com. And again, this is Prostate Cancer Awareness Month. All of us from Oster Oncology, we are here to help you fight stronger and fight smarter.